I wanted to start off this video by reminding everybody that I am a disruptor in the agricultural community. In most cases, there's a lot of people that give me distance. They don't want to be close to me because they're scared what I'm going to ask and they're scared what I'm going to say. Today, we've got a wonderful surprise. We've got Dr. Thomas Dykstra with us. He is, well, I tell you what, maybe I'll just let you do your...
Choose your words carefully, Mr. Rabenberg.
For the few people that don't know Dr. Dykstra, he's, it's going to hurt saying in front of you, but he's a quite famous scientist, world-renowned traveler, expert on a lot of different things, and it's starting to hurt, so I'll just let you give a little bit of information to maybe the three people that haven't heard of you or know you or haven't heard you speak.
Okay. To those three people, I haven't even started yet. I mean, I'm just warming up, okay? And you're already laughing at me. This is very, very emotional for me, okay? I grew up in Rochester, New York, and went to Cornell University. So a lot of my roots are from New York, or at least New York State. After that, after graduating from Cornell, I realized that I cannot take the cold, and so it was time to leave. But I had an entomology degree in tow, and then went down to the University of Florida, got two more entomology degrees. So now I have three entomology degrees. Because of that, this makes me more knowledgeable about insects than anything else, and supposedly nothing about anything else. Because when you get pigeonholed as to what you are a specialist in, everything kind of becomes much, much smaller at that point. And you find yourself in a very small area as to what you are able, or at least people are willing to listen to you talk about. So, however, for the PhD, things did take a turn. And in that time, I studied insect bioelectromagnetics. It's the bioelectromagnetics that has caused me to move into a slightly different field than entomology, although I still am dealing with insect bioelectromagnetics. And the bioelectromagnetics field has taken me to many different places. I consult in bioelectromagnetics. I also consult in agriculture. And of course, I still consult in entomology as well. So whether or not I'm consulting for an attorney, whether I'm consulting for an insurance company, termite inspections or other wood-destroying organisms, things of that sort, or whether or not I'm talking to agriculturalists, such as farmers or the like, or whether or not I'm talking to corporations who have advice that they need on bioelectromagnetics, then I'll also be consulting in that area as well. So there are three main areas that I do consult in, and this has been my life for about a quarter of a century, because I've been out of the PhD now for about that long. I own my own laboratory. It's Dykstra Laboratories Incorporated. Been there also for a quarter of a century. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. How am I doing so far? Yeah, I'm losing you. I just lost the three people that were listening to me on the video too. So thanks.
Well, when we first met in Canada...
I'm sorry.
Two of us.
Yes.
When we first met in Canada at the Bacteria Roots and Hybrix Manufacturing Convention, and I got introduced to you, and Cindy says, oh, well, this is Dr. Thomas Dykstra. He's an entomologist. And my first thought was, oh, great, a doctor who understands insects. And then we talked a little bit, and I thought, here's an hour and a half of his talk that I'm never going to get back. But then I started thinking, even before you started talking, it's like, well, wait a minute, if he understands insects, he understands why these insects are going to different plants. And then if he has to understand why these insects are going to different plants, he's also looking to see what those plants display that attract those. So all of a sudden now, this cat understands a little bit of plant physiology above and below the ground. And all of a sudden it's just like, this guy may actually know something. And again, I hate to say this, but I'm thoroughly impressed.
Say it.
With your first talk. So with all this, you understand what a healthy plant is. You understand what healthy soil should be. And I would like to talk about and get your take on this regenerative movement. Mm-hmm. When I hear regenerative, I think of shortening the word to regenerate, to rebuild, to restructure, to refurbish, to refortify. If you're going to rebuild something, you should know what it's made of so you can recreate that or a better version of what you have. I think the regenerative term has been prostituted. I think it's been overused. And in many times I question when they call something regenerative, my first thought is regenerative for who? So with that being said, the regenerative agricultural movement across the world by Thomas Dykstra, what's your take?
Why don't you tell me what you really think, Glen?
I'm on the fence.
You're on the fence about this one. I get it. Regenerative agriculture is something that I think is best understood if you understand the background in agriculture in general. So when you go back many decades ago, I would even say 50 to 100 years ago, there were two terms that were batted around. One is farmer. And the other is agriculture. And those words were absolutely fine. I love using farmer today. I love using agriculture today. But what we are getting into right now with the regenerative agriculture is we're now getting into a type of semantics. And so semantics have changed the issue somewhat. For example, I was at a meeting one time and I was repeatedly mentioning farmer this, farmer that. And I was approached later on and someone came up to me to correct me and said, we don't call them farmers anymore. And I was taken aback. And I said, what do you mean you don't call them farmers? What do you call them? And he says, we prefer the word producers. And I thought, producers, you know, there was this mystique that comes from farming and being a farmer. And now it was being you mentioned bastardized as a new word,
prostituted.
Maybe that's a better word. That the farmer is starting to move to the background, and so I asked some other people trying to understand why farmer is gone and why producer is in, and I said, can you tell me what is the difference between a farmer and a producer? And they said, yes, yeah, I can. They said, a farmer, well, you know what a farmer is. They said, I know what a farmer is. Maybe it's better for you to define what a producer is so I can understand this better so that I can use the word in presentations. And so they said, a producer? They said, this is someone who sits in a trailer, an air-conditioned trailer at their desk in front of a computer and monitors their crops. And I thought, whoa. So essentially what we're talking about is boots on the ground, no boots on the ground type of thing. Walking the field, not walking the field. And this is something which was hurtful. It still is. Even as I'm saying it right now, it's still hurtful to hear that. And I know it's true because I've seen this a lot, especially in Florida where I'm from, that producers have changed how farming is done. So this is why I want to mention semantics, because semantics and how you define something is important. And so now we move to agriculture. Well, agriculture is no longer enough anymore. Because it's not enough, new words have had to come out. And so we've had things like sustainable agriculture, which I get. And this is, can the system sustain itself where we don't have to keep putting more and more inputs in? Okay, I get that, and therefore maybe we can save money. I'm okay with sustainable agriculture. I'm comfortable with that term. That's fine. Organic agriculture is another one. I get that too. That's essentially just, okay, we're in agriculture, we're farming, and we're doing it organically, which in a nutshell means you're not using, you know, many of the pesticides, the insecticides, the fungicides, the herbicides, the nematicides, none of that stuff is being used. And that is what we call organic agriculture. So I said, that's fine too. I can wrap my head around that. That makes sense. Then we move into regenerative agriculture. Now, regenerative agriculture, as Glenn has mentioned, has that regenerative component in it. And therefore, when I hear regenerative agriculture, I think, aha, this makes sense. I see where we're trying to regenerate things, especially the soil, but we're trying to regenerate systems. And if that's the goal, then I understand regenerative agriculture. Of course, that can be done through organic agriculture. It can be done through sustainable agriculture. All of that can be done. But then regenerative agriculture has had a difficulty in receiving an acceptable definition. The definition has not been accepted. So if you do searches on the internet, you will see that regenerative agriculture is defined in many different ways. What I would like, maybe this is an appeal, is for people to get behind an accepted definition. Once we get behind an accepted definition, I can then let you know whether or not I'm behind it or not. Because right now, I don't know where I stand with regenerative agriculture. Why do I say that? Because one of the websites I got on had 17 different qualifiers as to what regenerative agriculture is. 17. I did not agree with all 17 of them. And so I thought to myself, am I supporting regenerative agriculture? The word, the meaning behind that word, the connotation, or am I not? And I realized if I can't support it, then I probably shouldn't use it. And so more recently, regenerative agriculture has meant one or two things. And this is also spreading like wildfire all over the internet. And that is environmentalism and global warming. Regenerative agriculture has been hijacked by these two. Clean water, clean air, I get it. However, when you take your eye off of that which is most important, you start sacrificing. And this sacrificing is happening right now because before, as farmers, we were more interested in the plant. We were more interested in the soil. Now, it's about, in some cases, not all, environmentalism and global warming. And you have now taken your eye off of the ball. And when you do that, you are no longer emphasizing plants. You're no longer emphasizing the soil. Everything serves that in some people's minds. Not everyone is comfortable with this. I'm sure some of the people who are listening to this right now are thinking, well, I don't support that. And it's true because many people will get on in various videos and say, what regenerative agriculture means to me, because they realize that there's no accepted definition. And then they will start to define it in a way that they are comfortable with doing. And when they're comfortable doing that, they have now defined it in a very particular way. It supports them, and it has nothing to do with what other websites are saying about regenerative agriculture. And so right now, as a scientist, I'm confused. I would like this confusion to disappear. I would like someone to actually come up with a definition, many people have, that is accepted. Everyone accepts it. This is what regenerative agriculture is.
Is general acceptance possible?
General acceptance is possible because I think that we have reached it with some of the other definitions. Agriculture is generally accepted. Organic agriculture is mostly generally accepted. We have a good consensus as to what that means. Obviously, the GMO situation has complicated organics a little bit, but generally it's accepted. However, when you have regenerative agriculture, which is now being defined by multiple different qualifiers, there can be no general acceptance. And so right now we need to get rid of the disparity. I think the agriculture needs to be more focused on than the regenerative part, because agriculture is about farming. It's about putting plants in the soil and watching them grow. This is why we do agriculture. The regenerative part is a qualifier for agriculture, and until it is defined and accepted by enough people that we can all get around it and say, this is regenerative agriculture, then we're off to the races and we're good to go. So that's where I have difficulty. I understand this is all about semantics, but semantics are important because I just got finished mentioning to you the difference between farmer and producer. I'm still okay with using farmer. I'm a little more uncomfortable with using a producer, but I also accept the fact that I'm from Florida and there are a lot of producers in the state of Florida, as there should be, because it can be difficult to spend 14 hours out in the field. So I get that part of it too. And so some of these are more comfortable calling themselves producers. So I'm a little bit more accepting of that. I just don't want to use them synonymously. And because I don't want to use them synonymously, I also don't want to be moving between regenerative agriculture and organic agriculture and sustainable agriculture and using these terms as if they're all synonymous with one another. Because right now, the regenerative agriculture has taken off. And in doing so, it is starting to leave some of the other definitions behind.
So the regenerative, we basically kicked the can down the street a little bit further than what other people have. And any definition that comes up, somebody's going to question it. Somebody's going to argue it. People are going to disagree with it. We both do a lot of traveling. We're both in with a lot of producers, farmers, growers, call them what you want. What I've been talking to farmers about, because it's a question that gets asked, is this regenerative? It's like, how about if we do a term that is understandable, straightforward, and I talk about healthy. And there's a lot of definitions for healthy. My definition that I like is without disease or impairment.
That's a safe definition.
But how do you qualify that? In the next video, we're going to talk about identifying healthy, and then you can determine whether that's regenerative or not. If this is good information, we're just getting started. There's way more that we're going to look at as far as identifying regenerative, identifying healthy, and in that identifying the healthy, what that comes back to is saving the grower, the producer, the farmer money. Dr. Dykstra, you've done a lot of videos on different topics. How can they view more of the things that you've seen?
It's relatively easy. If you go to YouTube and simply type Thomas Dykstra, my videos will come up very quickly, probably within the first 20 or so hits. I think I've got, 6 to 10. I haven't really counted them. Some of them are relatively long. Some are relatively short, but you'll be able to find them very, very quickly. Especially one video in particular, because if we are going to be talking about healthy plants, it would be good to review the BRICS talk. If you review the BRICS talk ahead of time, this will give you a much better idea of how to quantify health in a plant. Will give you the necessary background that you need, and will set you off to the races. I think you're going to be in much better shape, because I've got lots of slides and I describe it hopefully better than I am right now. But healthy plants do need to be discussed. This is the goal, because when they're not healthy, you are getting poor, tasteless, no odor.
Odor or aroma?
Aroma. No. Thank you for the correction. I appreciate that.
I'm here for you.
I'm glad that you're here for me, because otherwise, what would I do?
Well, we want to save some of this information for the next video.
Yes.
So we will, from our side, try to define regenerative and also healthy. How to identify it, and these healthy tips will help you lower your inputs, have better quality food with longer shelf life, and more economics in your back pocket at the end of the year. This information is to benefit the growers, the producers, and the farmers. So we'll have more videos with Dr. Thomas Dykstra coming up in the very near future. Thank you for watching.